Okay, and welcome to the Grind Podcast, Social Distancing Edition. I'm here with Michelle Burke from Bossibly. Hi, Michelle.
Hi, Arnell.
How's it going? Well, you know what? Oh, I totally forgot my coffee, but it's actually in the other room. It's too late. It's fine.
You're drinking it, so that's all that matters.
I'm drinking it. In theory, I'm drinking it.
Maybe you should add some whiskey to it, too.
Oh my goodness, let me tell you, with this coronavirus thing for sure. So this is the coronavirus edition of the Grind Podcast. This is the coronavirus episode, we should say. And we're going to talk a little bit about how the coronavirus is actually affecting companies out there. We've been in the grind for about, a month and a half since this thing first started picking up. And then within the last 3 weeks, it's been getting real. New York State is on lockdown, martial law, same with San Francisco. Brevard County has had its first cases last week. So things are pretty hectic. So we're gonna talk about how this affects businesses. And Michelle is gonna take the position of the CEO and managerial roles. And I'm just kind of gonna lay the groundwork and the framework for everybody. So Michelle, do you want to give us a little bit of insight on what you've been hearing on the ground in terms of from your business contacts?
So, I mean, it's all over the map. We have businesses that are CEOs that are actually not able to make payroll because all of their events or things that they're offering their clients are face-to-face, and there's no ability to work online based on the work that they do. And so in some cases, those businesses may wind up folding. I mean, they're trying to do furlough situations or let them go temporarily so that they can hire them back when this thing lifts. So that's one scenario. There are other businesses that are, it's business as usual, that they're used to working remotely and virtually. And so they haven't skipped a beat. And in some cases, they actually have more work as a result. And then you have the degrees in between. So then you have the people that maybe they have some remote workers and then some online. And so they're trying to get everybody else online and shift them. I talked to a business that went through a fire drill to get key fobs for all of their employees, like on a Friday. And then they issued them and those RSA tokens. So, you know, that's certainly an option. And then I think you were mentioning the other day about a business that is brick and mortar, a restaurant that's still doing well based on they've got a strong social media presence. Why don't you talk a little bit about that?
Right. So the way that I've kind of categorized it, again, there's obviously a range, but I'm going to basically take, if we're going to do on a scale of 1 to 10, with 1 being minimally affected and 10 being heavily affected, right? So we're going to work our way backwards, because I think that the businesses that are most heavily affected are those with brick and mortar locations. Their customers are required to come and meet them for the exchange of goods and services in person. And they have, and this is the qualifier, and they have little to no social media presence or digital presence. So they're not selling online. They have no Facebook, or if they have a Facebook, it's very minimal. There's not a lot of traction. There's not a lot of engagement. Instagram is gone, right? Forget about Snapchat or anything like that. So I think that those are, if you look at it, the mom and pop restaurants where they haven't done heavy investment in digital marketing or focused on digital sales, trying to pivot so rapidly is going to prove, without being able to have money to invest in a consultant or somebody that could help them pivot quickly, it's going to be difficult for them to make ends meet, because they're already coming so close to the line in terms of their profit margin. I really see a problem with them being able to, you know, survive this.
Is there any advice for those folks?
Sure. So there's the Small Business Administration has a loan that's been secured by the federal government, and that if you go to the American Small Business Development Council, you'll be able to see information on that loan. You can also, and
are they fast tracking that? Or because I heard some challenges with the lead time, but they are they adjusting that to fast track it?
Yeah, you can imagine what the application response time on that's going to be. Everybody's hitting them up. Luckily for us, you know, the initial bill that came out of the Senate was going to be only for $20 billion, and now that has been increased substantially. I'm not familiar with what the number was. I haven't had a chance to read the bill, but I will. And but all I know is that it's been you know, greatly increased. Like, of course, it's a loan, so you're going to have to pay that money back. But to get you through this time of need and this crisis, it's actually really, really important. So the second type of business, right, we're going to put people at a five, right, are the brick and mortar locations that have a digital presence. Now you have, again, a range. You could have a weak digital presence that you can, but one that you can build on because it's already established and maybe you've been doing some light investing into it, right? And then you have those that have an extraordinarily strong digital presence. And this one goes back to that, to the restaurant that you and I were talking about. So it's a local restaurant. It's actually in a very interesting location, not surrounded by a downtown center or, you know, an area that gets a lot of heavy traffic, but they have an extraordinarily robust social media. I mean, the owner posts constantly. It's a Puerto Rican Thai fusion restaurant. He's always bumping his mom, which is super cute. He has these cool specials where if his kitchen messes up an order, it's first come first serve, gets it for free.
He's creating engagement, and that engagement is keeping him top of mind for his customers. And how is he handling his employees in that situation?
Okay, so there's a couple of considerations. He has so much business that he actually has more businesses as opposed to when they're actually open. For dining in. Yeah, so that's the really interesting part.
Problem to have, I guess. Yeah.
Absolutely makes you wonder, like, do you then just become a curbside takeout?
Yeah, right.
But, food truck. you know, all of his posts are getting, you know, 400 plus engagements, whether it's, you know, somebody reacting or people commenting. His shares are in a silly number, you know, that they're the dozens and dozens and dozens. And so what he's actually doing with his employees is he actually put out a post today and that basically said, hey, you know what, we're going to be closed for Saturday, so today.
Yep.
And I'm thinking about closing permanently because, you know, I see that the potential for employees to potentially be infected and then come to work and you know, spread the virus.
Right.
He said, you know, I want to be socially responsible. Yeah. It's not all about the money. I got to protect my employees. I've got to protect my customers. So
he's minimizing the risk, choice. Right?
I mean, he gets to choose, right? He's not forced to take, like, you know, there's some places out there where the margins are so small that, you know, they have no choice or else they're going to fold. But
if you look at nationwide too, I mean, there are businesses that don't have the choice based on them being told you have no choice. You have to close, period.
Right,
move on.
Right.
I mean, I have just in my circle, I have, you know, my brother was laid off. My sister was laid off. Both nieces were let go, you know, cousins were let go. It's like, and that's, those were viable businesses. They were making money. Now they're not able to make money because the governments and the local municipalities said, nope, stop. Mm-hmm. And hopefully those folks, I mean, at least those in my personal circle have savings to actually combat that. Now I haven't talked to any of those business owners. I don't know how they're able to manage. I mean, they don't have the people payroll, right? But if they're brick and mortar, they still have leases to pay and things of that nature, you know?
Right. Yeah, and that's really up to the federal government or the local government to really step in and do something that makes sense. I mean, you know, even if you put a freeze across, across all of these liens, I mean, you tank the economy. So there's a fine line to play. I'm not envious of anybody in a leadership position at this point.
No, me neither.
That's tough. You know, in fact, so now let's go over to the last, yeah, right? The people that are just not going to be affected at all or very minimally. And of course, those are the people that are in the digital sphere entirely, yes, right? So I'm a remote worker. My clients are fine.
As am I, right?
They're fine in like their ability to access me. Now on their side, things are a little bit tenuous because they might not be a totally remote business. And, you know, some of them aren't. So they get hit, which, you know, in effect, the way that it affects me is that, you know, potentially my services may not be able to be paid for. So then I lose business. But, you know, as in terms of, is Corona going to be slowing down the speed of my work and my ability to telecommute or offer advice or complete my what I am under contract to do? No. And I'd love to hear your experience with it because I know that you have online classes.
So I actually have more work. So I'm in a position where, I mean, that's great. And I feel there's a part of me that feels guilty in that regard because I have people asking for assistance to work remotely or webinars or things of that nature. So, you know, that it hasn't impacted me adversely. Well, that's not true. I also have an Airbnb locally, and that April
everything got canceled, right?
Exactly. Yeah. So no, I mean, mm-hmm, as far as webinars and workshops and things of that nature, that has picked up for me. And what's cool about that though is, you know, I've been able to help some of my clients with the transition. So moving from a brick and mortar scenario where you have everybody face to face, now helping them learn the technology, helping understand what processes and tools they need to use, how to engage people remotely, because it's still, I mean, there plenty of businesses are doing it. So it's there's a learning curve that all of us need to go through.
Right. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the future in terms of management, right? Because that's where these changes have to be instituted from. You know, if you have cash available to hire somebody like yourself or myself that could help you pivot your business into a more digital minded sphere, and even like, you know, even if you think that your business isn't a particularly digital business, you might be actually putting the blinders on. It actually takes some sitting down with somebody like
good
myself,
point,
you know, or yourself to say, hey, you know what, is there a possibility to, you know, at least shore up my revenue here or protect my income streams? And then I'd be able to take a look at, you know, what you have in terms of your operations and say, okay, you know, this is how we kind of move or shift your operations to take advantage of certain aspects of your business that could be digitized and also monetized.
Exactly. That's beautiful.
Yeah. So from a manager or an executive point of view, what are some changes that you think are pertinent for them to deal with the situation right now, and then two, to actually mitigate this risk in the future, because it'll happen again.
Well, I think that having a strategy for pivoting is huge. So for the businesses that are brick and mortar, now they're learning the value of social media, right? I mean, you gave a beautiful example as to why a restaurant might want to do that. So that's, and I think that creates engagement and make sure that your business is top of mind, even when this stuff goes sideways. So I think that is an opportunity for businesses to start doing that. And there's a strong why they would want a social presence. So that would be one. I think the other thing, as it relates to their employees, I can't tell you the number of employees that I reference or that I come in contact with that want the opportunity to work remotely, even if it's 1 or 2 days a week. So this is a wonderful opportunity to start piloting that, you know, treat it like disaster recovery planning. And, you know, what happens if all of us have to go? What does that look like? Can you execute it? Plus you give your employees some flexibility. So I think that's the second point. And
that's a huge point.
It really is. And then I think the third point I would say is look at the work that you're doing, whatever, it doesn't matter what business you have, look at the work you're doing and is it profitable or not? Are you doing things that are profitable or not? And if the answer is you're doing stuff that's not profitable, then maybe you should be cutting some of those services, some of that work, so that then you can operate as leanly as possible to maybe continue to pay your employees or cut back on how your open hours, those types of things. That's what I would say would be those top three.
And that's actually a really good point. It's a good time for managers and executives to work together and kind of like look over their P&L statements and see where they can cut and minimize the overhead and make sure that they have a strong bottom line. You're absolutely right. Those are three amazing points. So I think that this is a good point to wrap up. This coronavirus thing has been crazy. We haven't even seen the peak of it. Apparently, that's going to be coming in 3 weeks. So supposedly, that's what the experts say. So we'll see. But in the meantime, we're all here. Kids are hunkered down. My kids have been working virtually on their schoolwork. So, but all Florida state testing is done. So we'll see what happens. And Michelle, always a pleasure talking to you.
You too. It's good to see you virtually. Yeah. And I think this has been great. I had my coffee. Yeah, now you got to go finish yours.
Virtual distancing. distancing. All right. Okay. I'll speak to you soon. And thanks everybody for watching The Grind episode. What is this? Two coronavirus.
Three? I don't know. Whatever episode it is. I don't know.
All right. Take it easy. Bye.